Human body is a complex machine. When the fetus is developing in a mother's womb, there are a lot of changes that happens. Although we know what changes happens, we still don't understand why those changes happen. For example, why is the brain sitting here and not somewhere here? And why is the heart shaped like that? And many more. There are many vital organs in the body without which we cannot function. Brain, heart, kidney, liver. There are many others. However, there are also organs called vestigial organs which are not of much functional use anymore. Examples are appendix, tonsils, tailbone, wisdom teeth, body hair. Body hair is really annoying, although there's been a new use for body hair. Body hair is now used for performing a hair transplant. So people who do not have an adequate donor area can actually have a transplant from body hair. I was surprised when I learned about this advance in medical science. Now surgeons love these vestigial organs because this is one of the commonest reasons why patients come to have a surgery. And obviously as an anesthesiologist, I have given anesthesia for many of these patients. If you're new here, I'm Dr. Rajiv Iyer, a board certified anesthesiologist and an associate professor of anesthesiology at University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. I did some reading about knowing about the origin of appendix as a vestigial organ. Interestingly, I found out it's been considered vestigial since the time of Darwin. So we got appendix from our plant ancestors. I can't imagine when this happened. Another interesting thing is, amongst animals, rabbits have an appendix. I couldn't figure out why rabbits have an appendix. However, cats, dogs, and many other animals do not have an appendix. Monkeys, they don't have an appendix, with the exception of apes like gorilla, chimpanzee, orangutan. The purpose of appendix is it's supposed to be a lymphoid tissue, meaning it helps us fight infection whenever there is. However, since this is vestigial, there are many other well-developed immune system in the body. For example, if you get exposed to a bacteria or a virus, your body can fight against it. During a lifetime, men have an approximately 8% risk of having an appendicitis, and women have 7% risk of having an appendicitis. Here is why the passing of food is important. As the partially digested food, which is now liquid poop, is passing from the large intestine into the colon through a valve called the ileocecal valve, some of the poop can actually spill over into the appendix. Sit there, and then it's going to come back. But if the poop gets obstructed here, it can bring in bacteria from outside, and this gets infected and inflamed, and this condition is called appendicitis. Harder the poop is, more chance it can get obstructed and then cause appendicitis. This can happen in people who have primarily meat-based diet and who lack eating fruits and vegetables which are high in fiber. Make sure you add fruits and vegetables in your diet to reduce your risk of appendicitis. If the inflammation is severe enough, the appendix burst opens, and this is called burst appendix or perforated appendix. This is a surgical emergency. It can spill in all the inflammatory cells and the pus from within the appendix into a place called peritoneum, and this can cause a condition called peritonitis, which is a surgical emergency, can cause fallen blood pressure and can also affect other organ systems. When appendicitis happens, the pain usually starts in the naval area and then slowly moves towards the right lower side of the abdomen. This is accompanied by nausea, vomiting, fever, loss of appetite, and this is when usually patients end up going to the hospital. When patients show up in the hospital, they end up getting an ultrasound of the abdomen, which is the commonest way to diagnose appendicitis. Some places also do a CT scan or an MRI of the abdomen, although this is not usually required. Whether the appendix is burst or intact, an appendectomy surgery is performed, and this is done under general anesthesia. Many years ago, when I was a medical student, the appendectomy surgery was done in an open fashion and was sometimes done under spinal anesthesia. Since the last 15 years or so, I have seen appendectomy being done as a keyhole surgery called laparoscopy, and the anesthesia of choice is general anesthesia. Anesthesia medicines like propofol and a muscle relaxant are administered to get the patient off to sleep. As the patient is going to sleep, they may feel some pressure on the anterior neck, and this is called cricard pressure. This is done to prevent any aspiration, and then a breathing tube is placed. Subsequently, many different medications are given to make sure the patient is safe and comfortable. At the end of the procedure, the breathing tube is removed. The recovery is usually quick. If the appendix is intact, the recovery is approximately a day. If the appendix is burst open, then the recovery might take a little longer depending on how severe the underlying infection is. There are things you can do to prevent this and stay away from the hospital. Increase fiber in your diet so the poop can pass very easily through the intestines without blocking the appendix. So increase your intake of fruits and vegetables. I have this video here which I highly recommend you to watch, where I have described the two options of how anesthesia is administered through a mask and through the IV. If you found any value with the video so far, don't forget to hit the like button. If you have any questions, post in the comments below. Take care, stay safe. I will talk to you soon.